All right, good morning. Are you awake? No, marginally. Okay, well, we're glad you're here. Thanks for making it here in your sleep. We're excited to worship together and be together here this morning. It was kind of a rough Sunday for the Packers last week. I know we shouldn't talk about it, but there still is going to be a Super Bowl in 2 weeks, or actually it's in a week, and the youth group is going to have a party. So high school, senior high youth group, next Sunday night, you get to go to the Super Bowl party at the Bankies. There'll be no youth group at the youth center. So the Packers aren't in it, but the Super Bowl party will happen next week at the Bankies home. Hey, this week, today is actually the Sanctity of Life Sunday. And we've been thinking about that a little bit with the baby bottle, the fundraisers for the Abiding Care Pregnancy Resource Center in Medford. I think you have 2 more weeks to return those bottles or think about a donation for them. But I also wanted to let you know that they're going to be talking about that in the adult Sunday school time today over in the Grove at 10:30, thinking about these things in the adult Sunday school time, the sanctity of life and personal ethics. So should be a great, great study and discussion there. During the education hour in here, the Discoveryland family will be happening. We have a really neat hands-on activity. And we actually have someone coming in to tell a story of how God worked in amazing ways in someone's life. We're also kicking off a new review game, Parents versus Kids. So parents, bring your A game, 10:30, okay? 10:30, Parents versus Kids with the review game. And then because Monday night is the family meeting here at the church, the annual meeting, when we kind of dismantle the chairs, we'll only do the first 4 rows of chairs here after church and have tables for DL family. We'll kind of leave the other chairs ready for tomorrow night for our meeting. So just so you're aware of kind of what the logistics will be going on there. Speaking of that meeting, tomorrow night, 6:30, here at church, Leah Sandoval sent out an email. Did you get that email? Yes, some did. If you didn't and you thought you maybe should have, check your spam or contact the church office. She sent the electronic documents that we will also have physical copies of here, and I saw that there are some physical documents on the kiosk, so if you want to be looking through those, check those out before tomorrow night. They're both available electronically and physically here. She also, in that email, sent out the Zoom link if that's something that you need for tomorrow night. And again, 6:30, we'd love to have you here at church or tune in at the Zoom. Okay, and then the women's ministry, we've been highlighting 2 opportunities, the discipleship group coming up and the game night coming up for women as well. So they would just ask that you would please sign up at the table in the back so they know how many to plan for those different events. All right, I think that's it for announcements. Take it away, Hoff.
All right, thanks, Brad. Why don't we stand? We've done this song in the past, but not enough to maybe remember. So we're going to do the chorus first. All right. Goes like this. Unto the one who sits on the throne, unto the Lamb who was slain, we all blessing and honor, glory and power and praise forever. Christ is the Lord, worthy forevermore. Is it one more time? Thank you.
Good morning, Woodland. It's great to see all of you here this morning. We're going to be opening our Bibles to Ruth and going to be talking about the Lord as our Redeemer. And what I love about the Bible is that there is themes in the Bible that are developed from the first page and continue to see throughout the Bible. And in youth group, in the fall here, we've been studying the book of Exodus, going through different stories, major stories in Exodus, and looking at these different themes that are developed in just the second book of the Bible, how they continue to progress and point us to Christ and the Gospels, and how they continue to prepare us for our Savior. And one of the major themes in Exodus is redemption. I mean, we start with a people in slavery, and they need a redeemer. They need someone to come and bring them out of slavery, out of darkness, and provide them with freedom, with a new master to follow. And that's definitely some of the themes we're going to be talking about this morning. And it brought me, as I was thinking about redemption, obviously to the New Testament, where we see lots of these themes of redemption. And I want to turn to Galatians chapter 4, where Paul talks about what it means to be redeemed and now to be bought back into God's family, and one of the really precious things we inherit, and that's prayer. And so we're in chapter 4 of Galatians, and I'm just going to read verses 4 through 7. Here it writes, "But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God." And that's exactly what we get to enjoy right now, is this direct connection that we have with our Father. We have been redeemed, and now we are called children of God. And so we have a direct line of communication. And we can bring to God anything we like because he's our Father and we're his sons. And so this morning, let us be praying in a way that we know that because we are saved through Christ, we have access to God. And so this morning, we're going to be praying for Donna Meisner. She is in Wausau, the hospital in Wausau, and she had a heart attack. And so she's still battling with some heart conditions and COVID that she has now down there. So let's be praying for Donna Meisner. We can continue to pray for others in our congregation that are facing health issues that we have in mind. And so let's just go to Lord in prayer with whatever we have on our hearts to talk to our Abba Father about. So Lord, we thank you. We thank you that you are our Father, that you've saved us, and you bought us back, and now we are called sons and daughters of our King, of the King, the Most High God. And so, Lord, we thank you for who you are and what you have given us through your sacrifice on the cross, Lord. Through your blood, we now have been bought back, and we're sons and daughters. And so, Lord, this morning, we cry out to you. We ask for your help and ask that your power be known in our lives, and that you would increase our faith and draw us closer to you, Lord. We pray for Donna and ask that you would give her healing, Lord. Give her strength for today. And, Lord, keep her eyes fixed on you as she continues to struggle with different health complications, Lord. Help her to find peace and feel your peace in this time, Lord, and feel the love of your saints as we lift her up and support her during this time. Lord, we pray for this service this morning. We ask that your Spirit would be alive in our hearts, in our minds, Lord. It's another thing that we inherit. We get your Holy Spirit, and we can cry to you, Lord. And so we ask that you would fill our hearts with your thoughts. Fill us with what the meditations that you would have us to dwell on and to take with us in this week, Lord. Help us to be people who are living in the Spirit, who are walking with you and following your guidance through the power and the direction of your Spirit, Lord. We thank you for who you are and the fact that you can talk to us and that you hear us. And so, Lord, lead us this morning, draw us closer to you, and make us just love you more and more each day. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand again.
gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer. There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am not forsaken. For by my side, the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing. For in my name, His power is displayed. To this I hold, my Shepherd will defend me. It has been paid, for Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are released, I can sing, I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me. soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior and life more abundant than fear. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light.
Let's do that chorus one more time. Last one is going to be new, and I'm going to teach you the chorus. It's like this. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us. Do it again. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us. For what we have done and left undone, we fall on our countless mercies. For sins that are known, for those unknown,
Bless you, Matt. Thank you. It's good to see you all this morning. So many of you I haven't seen in a while. What a group. Well, we've made it, haven't we, through what is often the coldest month of the year. And now we enter what is often the snowiest month of the year. And what do you know? Finally, we have some snow. It's a great time of the year to get into God's Word and go deep into God's Word and ask Him how He would teach us and how He would lead us. And really, that's the purpose of the annual meeting. We don't call it a business meeting. It includes some of those things. But really, it's kind of a state of the church meeting. And for us, it means coming to God together and discerning as a congregation where God would take us. And of course, we've been working toward this meeting for a number of months, and we'll continue to work after the meeting, because we never at any point stop asking the Lord to lead us. So do come to that meeting. You're all invited, and it'd be good to see you there. We're in three passages this morning. Mainly, we're in Ruth 4. Why don't we find that? A little book toward the front of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, the first little book that you come to. That's the main book that we're in. And then we're also going to look briefly at two other passages in the Old Testament. Leviticus 25, and then same chapter, different book, Deuteronomy 25. So however that works in your life, I don't know if you can do that on a phone, but if you have a paper Bible, maybe you can shove like a couple extra fingers or something in those two other passages, and we'll get there. Book of Ruth, let's remember where we've been. Ruth 1 is about emptiness and a return. It takes place mainly in Bethlehem. Geography is really important when you're in the narrative books, the books that tell a story. Bethlehem is the place. Of course, we know Bethlehem is an important place for other reasons. But long before Jesus came, the book of Ruth took place mainly in Bethlehem. And Naomi and her husband Elimelech go out with their two boys because of a famine in the land. And then 10 years later, Naomi comes back empty. That's the word. And Elimelech has died. The two boys have died. It was a plan that seemed good on the surface, but it wasn't according to God's plan. And the three women return, or the two women return to Bethlehem. And this word return is so important in Ruth 1. There is a return for Naomi, a physical, geographical return as she comes back to Bethlehem empty, as she says. But there's another turning in Ruth 1 as well. Ruth, the Moabitess who married Mahlon, one of the boys who died, has turned to the God of Israel. There's a spiritual turning, and it's that turning to the God of Israel on the part of a Moabitess who comes from outside the covenant that Israel lives under with Yahweh, the God of Israel. It's that spiritual turning that will become the important theme in the book. And we learned in Ruth 1 that when emptiness comes, turn to the Lord who has the plan that is far better than any plan that we could cook up on our own. Then we come to Ruth 2, which is about finding favor, a word that later gets translated as grace. This takes place in the field of Boaz. Ruth takes action, if you remember. She happens to come to the field of Boaz, who is a worthy man, and we see the unfolding plan of God. And as she works, Ruth attracts the attention of Boaz through her hard work, who already knows her by reputation, her reputation for faithfulness, loyal love, and kindness to Naomi. And then Boaz shows Ruth favor. He offers her protection. He provides her with an opportunity to work. And he includes Ruth in the care of his own servants. And he sends her home with provision. Upon which Naomi says, "May he be blessed by the Lord, whose kindness," that's that word chesed, "has not forsaken the living and the dead. This man is a close relative of ours, one of our redeemers." Now Naomi has a plan that is going to unfold in chapter 3. But for the moment, the women are provided for, and yet there's still no rest because there are no descendants of Elimelech. That line is going to die out. So with all this tension, we come to Ruth 3 that we were in last week, which is about provision. It takes place mainly on the threshing floor. Naomi sends Ruth to propose marriage in a very unconventional way. And Ruth is going to appeal to Boaz to serve as her kinsman redeemer. So she makes herself attractive, and she creeps in. This is not the way to do this. But she creeps in under the covers. All right, a scene that could have gone disastrously wrong had Boaz not been a man of God and Ruth a woman of God. And Ruth says, I am Ruth, your servant. Spread your wings over your servant, for you are a redeemer. And Boaz says, the Lord repay you for what you have done, and a full reward be given you by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge. Boaz is a Yahweh-fearing, law of God-abiding Israelite who recognizes Ruth's appeal to the God of Israel, and he promises to provide for her. But there's a complication, and that's the hook that takes us into Ruth chapter 4, where we are today. The complication is that there is a nearer redeemer. Ruth, or Boaz, was a relative of Naomi's, but he wasn't the closest relative. That's why we're going to have to get into those two other passages to see why this was a problem. And before Boaz marries Ruth, he has to give the redeemer an opportunity. And we remembered, as we finished up Ruth 3 last week, that God provides what we need in Jesus. Whether Boaz gets to marry Ruth or not, he is pledged to provide for her. He's going to take care of her. And of course, God does the same thing for us in Jesus. You see how Ruth is like a pre-picture of everything that we have that is true in Christ. So here we are, Ruth 4. We're actually going to divide this final chapter into two, so we don't have to finish this week. We're going to finish up next week, but we're going to look at Act 4 scenes, again, 1, 2, and 3, this week. And let me ask the Lord to bless our reading and understanding of his word before we even go there. Father, help us in this precious little book, Book of Ruth, written long before the coming of your son, Jesus. And yet it just shows us how the whole Bible, like Michael said, is tied together. And this theme of a redeemer, one who buys back with a cost, who pays the price, this theme of redeemer is one of the large themes in the Old Testament that opens up into the gospel and the work of Jesus. Help us, Lord, to connect here. Draw us in. Help us to see it and really go the next step in understanding all that you have done for us, Jesus. We pray this in your name. Amen. Three scenes, and like we've been doing in past weeks, I'm going to read them one at a time, so we won't read all the whole passage at once. This first scene I call gate. That's it, just one word, gate, because that's where it takes place, at the gate of Bethlehem, and it's only verses 1 and 2, so let's read it. Now Boaz had gone up to the gate, and he sat down there, and behold, the Redeemer, of whom Boaz had spoken, came by. So Boaz said, turn aside, friend, sit down here. And he turned aside and sat down. And he took 10 men of the elders of the city and said, sit down here. So they sat down. All right. So you have a business transaction that's about to take place. Notice here that Boaz goes into action. Chapter 1 was about Ruth and or Naomi and her emptiness. Chapter 2 was about Ruth and her initiative. You have Ruth doing things and Boaz saying things in chapter 2. Chapter 3 is all about Ruth and her bold action. And now Boaz, the man of action, is gonna take over the book. We read here, interesting phrase leading in. Now Boaz had gone up to the gate. This is a temporal clause indicating that this is going on while something else is going on. What's going on? Ruth is at home telling Naomi, like, what happened as she proposed marriage to Boaz. You can imagine, like, the Twitter patient and the excitement and the buzz. He said he was going to see that I'm redeemed, but, oh, there's this other guy in the way. I mean, this is complicated. All this is going on with all this suspense. At that time, Boaz is going up to the gate, and he goes up to the gate, and he sits down. Now, this is really interesting. we know that in 2 Samuel 23, which took place during the time of David, that Bethlehem was a walled city. So that took place later. We speculate by this description of this business meeting that Bethlehem was already a walled city. It was an important place. Yeah, it was small in later times. Not so important when Jesus came, but it was an important place. So there was a wall around this ancient city during this late Bronze Age, early Iron Age time in around the 11th or 12th century BC. The way cities were made, or gated cities in that time, was that as you approached the gate, so you couldn't just like climb over the wall, people didn't like that, you had to go through the gate, and as you went through the gate, there were little rooms on each side of the gate. So you had to go through this little passageway, and in these little rooms, there might be armed guards. So if you're trying to take this city, you go to the first room, there's armed guards here, armed guards here. Those aren't all the armed guards. You got to beat those guys. And then you go to the next room, and there's armed guards here and armed guards here. And so it's kind of this long corridor that makes it very complex to conquer. In peacetime, and I guess this was peacetime, these rooms were also the places where you could hold business meetings. And so Boaz is showing us his stature here. Not just anybody could go into one of these rooms and sit down and start a business meeting, and yet Boaz does that. He goes and he sits down, obviously an important guy, until, did you notice even the detail here? He finds a quorum of 10 elders. So this is an interesting snapshot of the ancient world. Stuff is just happening. He didn't like send out like stuff on Zoom and MailChimp and like spend months organizing this meeting like we have. He just goes and he sits down and he says, "Hey, you elder, come. And he collects 10 of these guys who apparently, I mean, they have stuff to do, but this is going to be the event. Boaz is an important guy. So they all sit down. They all sit down together. Then, this is really interesting, he sees the Redeemer, who is kind of the non-Redeemer. All right, he's not going to redeem, but he is the nearer kin. He sees this guy and he says, "Turn aside, friend. Sit down here." This is a very, very loose translation because we almost don't know what this expression means. This translation is almost a guess, and your different translations probably say different things. In the original, this expression, friend, means, or it says, poloni almoni. That's what the original Hebrew says. It almost sounds like Sicilian mafia. Poloni almoni. Right? It's an archaic expression, so it wouldn't have even been enforced during the time of the writing of Ruth, but it's a direct translation or a direct quote of what Boaz said. It means something like a certain one. It's not actually a name. It's more of a description. And it kind of rhymes, has kind of this jingly effect. And so a good translation would be something like Joe Schmo. Hey, Smokey, Joe Schmo, you, come over here and sit down with the elders. What did the guy think? He gets called over to this meeting. He's 10 elders sitting there, and there's actually more people gathering here. We know that from later in the passage. And so Joe Schmo, Poloni Almoni, the certain one, the nearer kinsman, comes over whether he wants to or not, and he sits down. And the fact that the narrator withholds his name is very important here because it indicates how we're to think about him. This one who is presented without a name has written himself out of the unfolding plan of God. He becomes so unimportant in this plan of redemption that he doesn't even get his name recorded. And so he's kind of a foil. He's given us to show us something about who Boaz is. So you've got a meeting. You've got a quorum with 10 elders. And they all sit down together to transact business. The second scene I call shoe. Just shoe or maybe sandal, because the shoe becomes important here, and I will read it for us. It takes place or starts in verse 3. It's the longest, goes down to verse 8. Let's read it together. Then he said to the Redeemer, Naomi, who has come back from the country of Moab, is selling the parcel of land that belonged to our relative Elimelech. So I thought I would tell you of it and say, buy it in the presence of those sitting here and in the presence of the elders of my people. If you will redeem it, redeem it. But if you will not, tell me that I may know, for there is no one besides you to redeem it, and I come after you. And he said, I will redeem it. Then Boaz said, the day you buy the field, oh, this is great. The day you buy the field from the hand of Naomi, you also acquire Ruth the Moabite, the widow of the dead, in order to perpetuate the name of the dead in his inheritance. Then the Redeemer said, I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I repair my own inheritance. Take my right of redemption yourself, for I cannot redeem it. Now this was the custom in former times in Israel concerning redeeming and exchanging. To confirm a transaction, the one drew off his sandal and gave it to the other, and this was the manner of attesting in Israel. So when the Redeemer said to Boaz, buy it for yourself, he drew off his sandal. Interesting stuff. There are three exchanges in this scene. Let's look at them. The first one deals with land. The first one deals with the land of Elimelech, and this is the point where I'd like us to flip back to Leviticus 25. Leviticus chapter 25. We're going to look at verses 23 to 28. I'll read it for us. We're thinking about how to redeem or buy back land in Israel. So this is a real estate passage. So those of us who are real estate agents, this is how it's done. Leviticus 25, 23 to 28. The land shall not be sold in perpetuity, for the land is mine. For you are strangers and sojourners with me, and in all the country you possess, you shall allow a redemption of the land. If your brother becomes poor and sells part of his property, then his nearest redeemer shall come and redeem what his brother has sold. So we see that playing out here in Ruth. If a man has no one to redeem it, and then himself becomes prosperous and finds sufficient means to redeem it, let him calculate the years since he sold it and pay back the balance to the man to whom he sold it, and then return to his property. But if he does not have sufficient means to recover it, then what he sold shall remain in the hand of the buyer until the year of Jubilee. In the Jubilee, it shall be released, and he shall return to his property. All right, you see what's going on here? God says that the land is mine. I have stewarded it to you by tribes and clans and by families, and you can't sell it outside the family. But if you're poor and you need cash, you can mortgage it outside the family. But then every 50 years, that's the year of Jubilee thing, it's a 50-year cycle, the land will revert back to the family that it actually belongs to. So this is kind of interesting if you're buying and selling and trading in ancient Israel. If you choose to redeem your land on year 49, so there's only 1 year left before the year of Jubilee, then it's not worth very much. If you redeem it on the first year of the cycle, then it would be worth a great deal. So that's the legal background to what is going on in this passage. Now, how does that actually play out in this passage? At this point, the footnotes are like crazy in the commentaries, because we're reconstructing something that happened in ancient Israel. My understanding is something like this. Well, it is this. The Redeemer, the non-Redeemer, right? We say Redeemer, Baloney Almoni, he assumes that Naomi had mortgaged the family farm, but maybe she's still living on it. This is something like what we would call a reverse mortgage. So she's selling it kind of like back to the bank, but she's still living on it for a time. He assumes that Naomi is trying to sell her way out from under this deal. He further assumes the price of the land will reflect the number of years left till the year of Jubilee. Except that Naomi doesn't have an heir. You see what the problem is here? He assumes in this lawless time that the land will remain with the buyer and he can add it to his estate. Okay, so you got law here and then you got the practice of how things actually take place. If you can't sell land outside your family, then if you can get land outside your family, it's really, really worth something. So this guy assumes that he can buy this property that has been mortgaged, and then after 50 years or however up to 50 years, then the deal will just kind of fall apart and he'll just get to keep it. And he'll be able to add it to his family. It's a little bit of a shady thing that Poloni Almoni wants to do. It's going to cost him something in the short run. He has to pay the purchase price plus the renovation price for land that hasn't been kept up very well. But it's a good deal for him. Who is the Redeemer thinking about here? Himself. He's not thinking about Naomi. He's not thinking about the law of Israel or Israel's God. He's thinking about making a good deal. Then we come to the second exchange. This is verses 5 and 6. The first exchange was about land. This is about Ruth. And I love how Boaz sets him up here. This reminds me a little bit of Jesus and the rich young ruler, where he sets the guy up to say the wrong thing that really exposes his heart. That's what's going on here. Then Boaz said, "The day you buy the field from the hand of Naomi, you also acquire Ruth the Moabite, the widow of the dead." You know, technology fails sometimes. We just go to a deeper form of technology. Paper. "The day you buy the field from the hand of Naomi, you also acquire Ruth the Moabite, the widow of the dead, in order to perpetuate the name of the dead in his inheritance." "Oh," says Poloni Almoni, "that changes things." And to understand how this changes things, we need to go to the other passage, Deuteronomy 25. Flip back a few books to Deuteronomy 25. We're going to read verses 5. We're going to read verses 5 to 10. This is going to help us understand what's going on here. Verses 5 to 10, Deuteronomy 25. And this is really, we're going to really have to think about this. "If brothers dwell together, and one of them dies and has no son, the wife of the dead man shall not be married outside the family to a stranger. Her husband's brother shall go in to her and take her as his wife and perform the duty of a husband's brother to her. And the first son whom she bears shall succeed to the name of his dead brother, that is, that his name may not be blotted out of Israel. And if the man does not wish to take his brother's wife, then his brother's wife shall go up to the gate to the elders and say, 'My husband's brother refuses to perpetuate his brother's name in Israel. He will not perform the duty of a husband's brother to me.' Then the elders of his city shall call him and speak to him, and if he persists, saying, I do not wish to take her, then his brother's wife shall go up to him in the presence of the elders and pull his sandal off his foot and spit in his face. And she shall answer and say, so shall it be done to the man who does not build up his brother's house. And the name of his house shall be called in Israel, quote, the house of him who has his sandal pulled off. End of quote. That's a long name. So the deal was one kind of deal as long as he was talking about Naomi, the widow who has no offspring, who will have no offspring. He's going to get her land. Suddenly, we have a young widow involved. What might happen with a young widow? Well, following the law, she'll have children. These children will be the legal heirs of Elimelech and Mahlon. They will then inherit the land, plus they'll inherit a portion of the Redeemer's land. You see, what Poloni Almoni learns here is that looking out for the well-being of someone else is costly. And at this point, he backs out of the deal. Exchange number 3. This is about the closing of the deal, verses 7 and 8. Here we have an explanatory comment. So this is interesting. Our narrator, who is writing from a time much later than the events of the book of Ruth, has to explain to his original readers and to us what is going on here. And he has this thing here about the shoe. When you make a deal, you pull the shoe off, and that's the deal. It apparently had gone out of practice by the time of the writing of Ruth, but it's based on the Deuteronomy 25 passage. This is kind of sort of like, but totally unlike Cinderella. And yet there's a girl involved. So to make a deal, you give someone your shoe. There's nothing written down, but there's witnesses in a culture that has a long memory. And if that deal is ever contested, the person with the grievance then produces the shoe. I got your shoe. Remember that deal? This would be a great way to do our business meeting tomorrow night. You know, instead of writing everything down and having to keep up with all of that, we could just vote on things like exciting things like establishing the quorum for all of other meetings this year. And then when we vote, we could just all exchange shoes. And we go home with, like, you know, different shoes. And then later on, if somebody gets upset, I got your shoe. That would have been the way they had done it. Notice here that the non-redeemer, he shows no loyal love, no faithfulness, no kindness. He retreats in shame. His name is never given, blotted out of the record. He's not part of God's unfolding plan. And I love the mental image of this guy trotting off with one shoe. It just closes the deal for me. I love it. How is Boaz different from the non-redeemer? That's a question we get to think about as we read the third scene. I call this third scene house, as in lineage, as in family tree. Verses 9 down through verse 12. Then Boaz said to the elders and all the people, you are witnesses this day that I have bought from the hand of Naomi all that belonged to Elimelech and all that belonged to Chilion and to Mahlon, also Ruth the Moabite, the widow of Mahlon, I have bought to be my wife to perpetuate the name of the dead in his inheritance, that the name of the dead may not be cut off from among his brothers and from the gate of his native place. You are witnesses this day. Then all the people who were at the gate and the elders said, we are witnesses. May the Lord make the woman who is coming into your house like Rachel and Leah, who together built up the house of Israel. May you act worthily in Ephrathah and be renowned in Bethlehem. And may your house be like the house of Perez, whom Tamar bore to Judah because of the offspring that the Lord will give you by this young woman. The first part of this is about witnessing the redemption. First the land, and then the widow. Also Ruth the Moabite, the widow of Mahlon, I have bought to be my wife, he says. Now at this point, we have to fight back against the revulsion that we feel about one person being purchased by another person. Remember, we are in a lawless time here where the first people abused were women and children. People were trafficked all the time. Remember, Boaz is buying Ruth not into slavery, he's buying her out of slavery. He's buying her out of death. He's buying her out of destruction. And why is he doing this? Notice he explains this. To perpetuate the name of the dead and his inheritance, that the name of the dead may not be cut off from among his brothers and from the gate of his native place. The worst thing for an ancient Israelite was to have your name blotted out, to be remembered no more, to be separated from the land so that you are not remembered among God's people. The unredeemer, the non-redeemer, his name has been blotted out in the record, but Boaz we're still talking about. Boaz, at great sacrifice to himself and to his own estate, loved Ruth. He's going to make her his wife, but he also loves her mother-in-law, and he reveres the dead. He loves Israel. He loves God's law, and he loves Yahweh himself. Boaz pays the price for Ruth's redemption. That's the key idea here. And then there's a blessing. As the people, you can imagine, you started out 10 elders and the one guy. Now you got a lot of people who are standing around because there's like a wedding taking place. This is a big deal, right? Boaz getting married. And, you know, I always remember couples when we do weddings. I always remind them there are no spectators at weddings. It's not like we're up here doing something and you've got a lot of people who have bought tickets and they're sitting out there, you know, cheering and whatever stuff. They're spectating. They're not. They're participants. And in fact, I always tell the young couple that if you guys start messing up, if you split and we find out you're living in different places, all these people who are here are going to come looking for you. They're going to find you and they're going to bring you together and they're going to make you talk and we're going to restore this marriage. So you got all these participants here going on, and they say, may the Lord make the woman who is coming into your house like Rachel and Leah, who together built up the house of Israel. Rachel and Leah are the mothers of Israel, the wives of Jacob. Why is Rachel listed first? Well, because like Ruth, Rachel was barren until God opened her womb in his time and in his way. And then she said, and they say, may your house be like the house of Perez, whom Tamar bore to Judah because of the offspring that the Lord will give you by this young woman. Who are these people? Well, Perez was the son of Judah by his daughter-in-law. That's very bad. Tamar, right? Remember Genesis 19. We looked at it last week. That's about the seedy ancestry of Ruth. Genesis 38 describes the seedy ancestry of Boaz. And as that story interrupts the account of Joseph, it becomes important in Israel's history. Judah's son Ur dies, and there's an unsuccessful levirate marriage. That's that marriage arrangement with the brother. Tamar isn't patient to wait for the young son to grow up, and so she plays a prostitute and has a child by her father-in-law, and two children are produced, Zerah and Perez. Now, the idea is that's bad. But God blessed them because of his sovereign grace and what he was doing in this chosen line of people. God blessed her with twins. And the idea is that if God would bless Tamar with twins, If God would establish the line of Judah despite obvious sin, how much more? How much more will God bless the loyal love, the faithfulness, the kindness witnessed in the union of Boaz and Ruth? And so we see here in this chapter that Boaz pays the price for the redemption and restoration of Ruth and Naomi. He goes above and beyond, which is what chesed is all about. He went more than the bottom line. He completely invested in them. Now, next week, we're going to tie it all together. We're going to make this connection to Jesus as we close down this book for a while. But even today, let's remember that God himself pays the price of our redemption and restoration. In whom? In Jesus. What we get here in Ruth is a pre-picture of the work of Christ. In one of the biggest themes that we have in the entire Bible, the theme of Jesus is our Redeemer who pays the price to buy us back from sin and death. Can I read you just a couple of verses? I want to make the connection to Jesus here because it's just too obvious. I can't wait for next week. Hebrews 2:14. Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things that through death, there's Jesus paying the price, he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. There we were in slavery, dying, and Jesus paid the price to buy us back from sin and death. Philippians 2, 6 and 7, we know so well, have this mind among yourselves which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. It isn't just Jesus' death on the cross that redeems us. It's him becoming one of us, entering into our filth, entering into our viruses, growing up with our problems, taking on our human weakness, and then in a culminating act, dying for us to buy us back, this idea of redemption. 1 Corinthians 1:30, and because of him, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. And there are literally hundreds of passages and verses in the New Testament that we understand better if we understand what's going on in the book of Ruth that prepares us for the New Testament. Like Ruth, we need redemption. This may be the central human problem that we have. Most of us don't think, well, we all are born into life thinking we don't need redemption. We're consumed with our rights and our power plays and, you know, what I think I have coming to me. I don't think of myself as a person who is dead, who is in slavery, who is apart from God, who is desperate without recourse in the world. But the Bible, the book of Ruth, the New Testament, the gospel helps me know that I need redemption. And Jesus' work is pre-pictured here as he chooses to enter into sinful humanity and he takes our sin on himself. And so that's the beauty of this book. And I get to go through this whole week and I get to go through the rest of my life understanding Jesus better if I understand the book of Ruth. Lord, help us. And first of all, thank you for this ancient story that prepares the way for Jesus. Here we are, Jesus, looking back on your work at the cross, looking forward on your return, knowing that mainly at the cross, but also we're told at your return, you're going to buy us back from sin and death. Our part is to respond to you in faith. Our part is to depend on you, to trust in you, to believe that it's true, that you're who you said you are, that you did what the Bible says that you did, to depend on you by faith. And then we are saved, and we get to look forward to everything that relates to our fallen humanity being redeemed at your return. Huge, Lord. And here again, Lord, in the midst of your people, we just want to proclaim to you that you are our hope. You are our Redeemer. You're the one who has done it and will do it. You have redeemed us. And so we just want to declare our trust in you. And to the degree that we're not trusting in you, maybe we're not trusting some, maybe somebody's not trusting you at all. Lord, would you help us by your grace? Help that person to depend on you for the first time today. And for all of us who have trusted in you in a saving way in the past, we need every part of our lives to be redeemed by you. We need your Spirit to work in us. Would you do that work in us this week? Thank you, Lord Jesus, for who you are. You are our Redeemer. Amen.
Let's stand. I hear the Savior say, my strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray, find in me thine all in all. Jesus, pray all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Oh, nothing good have I, whereby thy grace to claim. Wash my garments white in the blood of Calvary's Lamb. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a are dismissed. Remember, we have at 10:30 education hour. There'll be an adult class in the other room, the Grove. And Brad, what did you call it? What was in here today? The whole family. It's going to be a little competition, right? So have a great morning. We'll see you next week, if not before.